little bit different. So I'll just first ask a general question to all the four of you, whether you found this a bit too out of the box, or whether you found it an interesting way to address issues of justice, human rights, peace, which are your daily bread. So just like a little round of a sense of what you felt about it, and then I'll come to you one by one to ask you for your inputs. So overall, could I get a general sense? Was that an interesting format for you? Yes? Great, okay.
Talk about the format?
Well, I just wanted to get a sense of whether you found the format interesting. So kind of a nod of the head is a good way to start.
Well, for me, this is...
Me to use your microphone.
Well, I think the format and the way...
You need to be just a little closer if you don't mind. Yeah, I think they're all on. They're just a very sensitive, yes.
Yeah, well, let me just say that I'm very pleased with the way the whole setup has been created, and so far I'm very privileged to be a member of this very distinguished panel.
Thank you. So, that's great. Let's have a little round of what your feelings were to this format.
Thank you very much, first of all, for inviting us to be part of this panel. And I would like to express my full appreciation and my congratulations for the excellent performance, the students, and the performance on your behalf, Professor. And I think it was the best way to send the right signals what a transformative justice is, to be inclusive, to be for all the people, mm-hmm. and to work for the reconciliation and for peace. And those signals are very, very clear and very loud through the performance that we are privileged to see. Thank you very much once again.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Professor Moni, students, faculty, and well done, beautiful, very impressive. I'm coming from a country that's hit by conflict for so many years. I learned from your session. Beautifully said, very artistic, and very comprehensive. Thank you very much. I enjoyed it.
Thank you to our students. Please.
Thank you. First of all, on behalf of Ambassador Londonio, she apologized, but as you mentioned, she had a last minute call and she's out of Geneva. Also, thank you for the invitation to our mission and to our country to share this experience. Also, congratulations to the students. And yes, of course, very interesting on these alternative ways to present issues that we discuss in our daily cases. It's a good way to refresh ourselves with the message that are important. And as the ambassador of Chipre said, one important thing because transformation and reconciliation. And for that, one important thing is to listen to each other and to hear every part of the stories that sometimes we forget.
Thank you so much. Well, thank you for that first impression. And now what I will do is just go in turn to each of you and ask you for your reflections, your perspectives on this notion and practice of transformative justice, what you saw presented, how this applies to, in your cases, to your own countries, which, as you mentioned, are in different stages of this process of transition and transformation. And we will hear, therefore, first from Ambassador Dalil, then from Ambassador Ignacio, then from you, Carlos and Enrique Valencia, and then, for a more global perspective, we will come to you, Dr. Abdelmina.
Thank you, Dr.
Moni.
I think justice is...
I think the mics are very sensitive, so if you could have a sense in the back of the room, should it simply be held a little closer, or should the volume be turned up? Yeah, if you realize coming to her, so perhaps just holding a little closer may work.
I will try. Justice is an important mechanism and process and tool for a number of issues. Of course, for human rights and for universality of human rights, but it's also an important element for security and for development. The structural inequalities that cause conflict and poverty, whether those in structural inequalities coming from gender, from geography, from ethnicity, from language, has to discussions in the transitional justice and transformational role of justice, which is civil and political rights and social and economic rights. Yes. Okay. So my point is
on land. And that should be actually sound like a platform.
So I will repeat myself. So I think what's important in our country, in Afghanistan, we have seen a progressive realization of human rights as well as justice in the last 1.5 decades. So for us, that has been a journey, and it's important to see where we have started that journey and that path, because for those of you who do not know the country or have less information about the country, we started from a situation in the 1990s where casualties, injuries, and war-related casualties was tremendous. We started in a situation where many of us, including people who are in this room and myself and my colleagues, we faced displacement and migration. We started from a situation where women were not allowed to go to school or to go to work only because of the biological differences. We started in a situation that, of course, with underlying poverty, we had a very low human development index worldwide. So from that basis, the journey started, and with commitment from political side and political leaders, with inspiration from the international community, with a lot of dedication, at the same time keeping security in balance, because you are in a situation where you have preparators or who practice violence, at the same time you have victims and you have civilians and you have former military and commanders and so on. But meanwhile, the country had a priority to keep peace and security and a durable security and peace in a real sense. So that's where we understand the interface and the connection between security, justice, and development. Mm-hmm. And they are mutually reinforcing each other and they are inclusive. I would also like to put into this scenario the issue of welfare, and especially social welfare of citizens. Because when you talk about justice, when you have to bring the development element into it, especially if you're talking in a very poor resource country in terms of development, I mean not in terms of natural resources and opportunities, but in terms of income, you have to have a determination on citizens' welfare. And that brings us to very basic things that might be basic in a number of other countries. For example, access to education, especially for girls. For example, access to healthcare. For example, access to electricity and having infrastructure and roads. And this is also part of the citizens' welfare that helps the pathway for justice and transformation. Let me also put some highlights in terms of what we have done in the last 15 years. And one of them is the constitution of 2004 for the country. The constitution is a broad-based constitution. It reflects on human rights, and it has considerations and commitments on human rights. This is the first constitution for the country where the rights for all citizens, men and women, rights and duties are equally defined. And I think to have that platform or that basis, that legal basis for the country was an important achievement. The judiciary system also plays a great role into this pathway. And coming from that background, the building a capable and professional judiciary system, which is responsive, which is efficient and effective, takes time also. Hasn't been easy for us because it's a system building process. It's an institutional building process, but the country and the
The government is committed to make sure that the judiciary system is transparent and respects the human rights and respects the constitution. For Afghanistan, we have an independent human rights commission, and this is different from a number of countries in the region. This is different from our neighbors. This is different from the region that we are located. So we are very proud that we have a watchdog who observe, who monitor the actions and the progress that we make on the human rights journey. I think, let me also, since the turn is mine, if you allow me, please, let me also share with you one of our lessons learned, mm-hmm. and that's empowerment of communities. Because we believe that the justice and transformational should not be a top-bottom approach. It should be rather, as you say in the performance, it should be human-centered. It should be community-based, with engagement from communities, from individuals, who are either victims or witnesses, or those who were part of the violation, as well as, and then coming to the top, because it has to be seen as a population-owned, population-managed, or population-process, population-based process, which gives credits to individuals and to communities themselves. And that's where you bring a deliberate peace. Otherwise, a top-down approach would be very symbolic, very non-organic, and it could impact security and peace. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That was a very powerful message that you ended with. Thank you so much for sharing with us the experience of Afghanistan. And I have to just mention, since you mentioned the Independent Human Rights Commission, your fellow doctor, Dr. Seema Samar, who's also a laureate of the Alternative Nobel Prize, had addressed our students just a week ago. And I see my colleagues from the Right Livelihood Award Foundation over here. So we've really benefited from the experience of Afghanistan. Thank you so much. I turn to you, Ambassador Ignacio, for your comments.
Thank you very much once again. And I'd like to thank my colleague from Afghanistan for sharing with us the experience of her country. Unfortunately, I will not be in a position to speak today about the success story regarding solving the Cyprus problem, as it is the case of Afghanistan, or as it is recently the case of Colombia. And I would like to congratulate my colleague for this amazing settlement that they were able to find recently to solve the conflict in Colombia. Before I will share with you some of our experience about our efforts to solve the Cyprus problem.
Just a little bit closer, Ambassador, yes.
Yes, and before I share a few comments about our experience, I would like to make a general comment regarding transformative justice. Transformative justice needs to be comprehensive. It cannot be restricted to criminal justice, which is the traditional association we make when we talk about justice every day. It needs to be broad and inclusive. And these were the message that we received from the performance of the students before starting our panel discussion. It must facilitate reconciliation, and it must enable restoration of political equality, the full enjoyment of rights and freedoms, and the justice to all individuals and groups of the population as well, in a variety of everyday life, such as politics, religion, economic empowerment, respect for and access to cultural heritage as well. Coming to Cyprus now, Cyprus presents a unique and complex case for transitional justice. It is important to recall that in societies that are struggling with legacies of conflict-related violence, the past does not resist neatly in the past. Unfortunately, it continues to live in the present and play a role in how communities and societies shape their future. One of the aims of transitional justice in Cyprus is to challenge dominant discourses about the past in order to restore trust between citizens and institutions, between both communities, the Greek Cypriot and the Turkish Cypriot community. I would like to share with you some of our efforts and what we are doing in this respect. And all of you, you know that for more than 40 years now, we have been working towards achieving a political settlement that will end the forceful division of my country. And this is done through intercommunal negotiations conducted by the leaders of the two communities with the support of the good offices of the UN Secretary General. Furthermore, for the past 10 years, there has been an increase of discussion from civil society, academia, professional associations, trade unions, political parties, and arts communities. This is to overcome the burden of the past in order to create a more peaceful future. For example, we produce films made about conflict-related violence and its impact on society. And in this respect, the performance we saw before is an excellent example how we can promote transitional justice. In the same way, the International Center for Transitional Justice in Cyprus helped civil society victims groups to address the island's violent past. I will give you some examples, specific examples, what we are doing in Cyprus in order to be able to build confidence, reconciliation, and enhancing the sense of justice without focusing on the element of punishment. I would like to mention briefly four aspects of what we are doing. We have set up the Committee on Missing Persons. The primary objective of the Committee of Missing Persons is to locate, recover, and identify the remains of missing persons and return them to their families. The committee comprises a Greek Cypriot member, a Turkish Cypriot member, and a third member from ICRC, who is appointed by the United Nations. As of 13th of November 2016, the number of identified missing persons is 737 from a total of 2,001 missing persons. However, there are still 955 Greek Cypriots missing persons and 309 Turkish Cypriots, so we have a lot of work to do in front of us. Secondly, we have set up a number of bicommunal working groups on governance, power sharing, European Union matters, security and guarantees, territory, property and economic matters, and several technical committees aimed at reconciliation and confidence building, focusing on issues such as culture and cultural heritage, education, environment, health, economy and trade, crisis management, crime, gender equality, of course, etc. We have facilitated and supported very much the development of interreligious dialogue between the Archbishop of Cyprus, the Greek Orthodox Church in Cyprus, and the Turkish Cypriot Mufti. This dialogue has been very successful with the active engagement and support of the United Nations Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Religion and of Belief, Professor Bielefeld, that is now presented as a model for religious understanding and coexistence in the broader region of Eastern Mediterranean and the Middle East. Finally, I would like to mention an initiative that we took here in Geneva, and this is in full conformity with the part of your performance regarding the cultural heritage, the protection of cultural heritage, cultural rights. recognizing this important role that respect, protection, and restoration of cultural heritage can play in facilitating transformative justice through reconciliation, Cyprus led a core group of countries that tabled the first relevant resolution of Human Rights Council last September. The resolution, adopted by consensus, recognized the destruction of cultural heritage as an aggravating factor in conflict and a major obstacle to dialogue, peace, and reconciliation. It acknowledged the importance of early restoration and the full enjoyment of cultural rights to individuals affected by conflict, and recognized the important contribution that United Nations peacekeeping missions can make in protection of cultural heritage and safeguarding of enjoyment of cultural rights. With this example, I would like to pass the floor to the...
We go here and then come back. Wonderful. Thank you. That is excellent. You know, we really wanted to choose countries which are at different stages of the process of transitional justice. And so it's very educative to see how, even though Cyprus is still in a stage of long-term conflict, how many initiatives you've already taken to already be considering cultural rights and cultural heritage, to be considering reconciliation and dialogue at all levels of community. So this is now the exciting new initiative, which is the peace process in Colombia, which has gone through few steps back, but now a great, great step forward. So welcome, and we look forward to your insights.
Oh, thank you. For those of you that are not familiar.
Is the mic okay?
Yeah. I'm not familiar with the Colombian situation. You know, you are very in the front pages of the news in the last months. After 4 years of negotiation, we reached a peace agreement with FARC, and that we put it on a boat. The last 2nd of October, people say no to the agreement, 50% against 49. So after that, we start again a national conversation, especially with all the sectors that say no. That means the right wing and also the Christian movements that were the major part of the no. And after a lot of consultation, we reached a new disagreement with FARC that are now in the latest stages of the confirmation by the Congress. So we hopefully are going to refrain that new peace agreement and have start to implement it as soon as possible. So with that background, I just want the first remark I would like to say is that the end of the conflict and peace is the best way to assure justice, to assure proper society, prosperous societies, and the fulfillment of the rights of all the citizens and all the inhabitants of the country. So this is a main base. In this opportunity, I would like to share the way we see the transformative justice and how we put it in our agreement, in our process. So. Justice was one of the most complex items or elements during the negotiation, and of course is one of the most criticized chapters within the peace agreement, especially because the discussion about, as it was two different things about peace and justice, how many justice we are willing to lose, or lack of justice we are willing to accept in order to reach peace. That was the kind of discussion that we had, and especially because a lot of Colombians didn't understood or the other way around. The government failed to convince our population of the benefits of the peace agreement, and especially the benefits on justice, because during the process, the Colombian government was very careful in that anything that was agreed was in line with our international obligations and with international standards, as it is recognized by the Office of the High Commissioner of Human Rights, and it is recognized for several NGOs. But yes, the Colombia Peace Agreement is
a point of inflection. It's a turning point in the transitional justice world. And that is said by a lot of academic and also a lot of NGOs. Because for the first time in the world, we have, in the framework of the peace agreement, to end an internal conflict, a comprehensive transitional justice system agreed that specifically includes the creation of a domestic special jurisdiction to investigate and prosecute international crimes. So the experience in Colombia could be an important reference in the future for other countries or for other processes, especially in the current situation and the current international and legal framework. So why is so innovative this peace process of this component of justice in the peace process of Colombia? I can say two reasons. The first one is the integrality.
Exactly.
The agreement has a holistic approach. So we built an integral system for truth, justice, reparation, and guarantees of no recurrence. We established in the peace agreement several mechanisms in order to assure this. So we have a commission of truth that are going to revisit the story of the conflict in Colombia and see the other voices that sometimes we lose when we study our own conflict. Second, we have a finding unit for all people who have disappeared in our conflict. Recent studies said that in Colombia we have a big amount of people, and that it's not only people who suffer enforced disappearance, but also people in combat and all the parts within the conflict. The third is the peace special jurisdiction, Justicia para la Paz, is the name, and also several mechanisms for reparation to the victims. So, the first element, important element, the integrity. And the second, and that's why it's transformative, we believe, is the restoration. That means that victims were in the center of the disagreement and were in the center of the component of justice. That means that this component is not only a penal or criminal justice, but is a really restorative one.
Exactly.
Where we try to restore all the rights that the victims lost. So in this regard, we included a differential approach in order to be more sensitive for every victim. We have a gender approach, we have ethnic approach, and we recognize the impact, more critical impact that the conflict has in some communities, in some populations, and is recognized in the peace agreement. So that doesn't mean that we wait to the peace agreement to start to reparate the victims. Since 2012, we have a law that tried to address that problem, and we have now registered 8 million people, 8 million Colombians that are victims of our conflict. 6 million of them are applied for reparation. So this is a huge, not only logistic, but also financial challenge for our country. So just to finalize, some lessons that we can share, or some good practice of our process is, first, the importance to address the needs and expectations of all the victims. And this is important because sometimes different victims can have different expectations. One victim can be jailed, to see the perpetrators in jail. For the other victim, it could be just the truth, to know what happened with his family or with his loved one. The second is the participation of all actors, especially to take into consideration, high consideration, the voice of victims during the process, but also in the implementation. And here the role of civil society is very important. The third is the accountability, that means to have or implement clear and transparent mechanisms to monitor the implementation. And another important element is the positive role of international community, how they help us during the more complex moments in the negotiations, but also they're going to be critical for the implementation of the agreements. And in the agreement itself, they give some roles, some particular tasks to some agencies and to international actors. And finally, the most important lesson is the opportunity that this agreement gives us to mainstream human rights.
Exactly.
In our national policies, in our programs, and to hear to see the change in the people minds, and they are now talking in a human right and human rights based approach, a human right clue. So that are the important elements that I wanted to share with you. Now the challenges are a lot. I mentioned logistic, but also financial, especially to the implementation in the rural areas, and that the victims and all the groups that are affected can have a reconciliation and reparation.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And it's actually great that we kept Colombia, the case of Colombia, as the third example, because I remember when we had the first session of transformative justice in this room and we were sitting here in a circle, one of the first questions that was asked, because most of our participants come from countries that have experienced different forms of violent transition or violent situations, they said, isn't this a bit utopic? Is it really possible? And what I've always felt, despite the slight setback with the referendum, is Colombia is really a case in point of not simply having an ambitious objective, but actually having the commitment, the political will, and the public participation to realize that objective. So really a case of transformative justice in point, even though the large challenge remains. So before we open up for a dialogue with the audience, I turn to you, Dr. Abdelmoula. You set the context for us, a few of your insights on the path ahead for transformative justice.
Well, let me just start by offering a few personal remarks. The issue of transition...
Just again, I'm just going to request you, unfortunately, because it's so sensitive, to hold it really close.
I thought it's on.
Yes.
Yeah, the issue of transitional justice for me is very much personal as much as it is professional. As a lawyer and someone who has been working in the field of human rights, I always found it to be the most fascinating aspect of the work that we do. But much more personally, I am someone who comes from a very divided society. I am originally from Darfur. And as many of you know, Sudan has been going through one turmoil after the other. Dividing the country wasn't enough. There is a war going on in the two Sudans right now. So if there is a place that is in dire need of transitional justice and reconciliation, this is my own country of origin. But I've also been very privileged to work in other contexts where I try to contribute to transitional justice and reconciliation. My first UN assignment was in Somalia. This was over 20 years ago, and there we tried immediately after the collapse of the regime there to start something like a reconciliation mechanism, even before transitional justice was less fashionable than it is today. Also, I have had the opportunity to work in Iraq in 2003, immediately after the American intervention in the country. Ironically, 2 days before we got bombed in the Canal Hotel, we had a transitional justice workshop in the Canal Hotel, and 2 days later, we got bombed and had to leave the country. But I was also lucky to go back to Iraq 10 years later, in 2013. In a different capacity this time, not as a human rights officer, but as the head of UNDP there. And the first thing that we did was a big project that is still ongoing in Iraq on transitional justice and reconciliation that is right now in full swing. After the 2003 episode in Baghdad, I was posted briefly here in Geneva, but I opted to go back to the field, and my destination was Liberia. And this was immediately after the signing of the Accra Agreement, and it fell on our shoulders, on me, on my particular shoulders, to come up with the first draft of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission for Liberia. The record in that regard is mixed. We tried to our level best, given the various challenges associated with the transition at the time, to come up with a meaningful truth and reconciliation process for Liberia. Now, that's all to say that I have had the opportunity to both work on and interact with colleagues who are working in this field across the world. One, I'm going to share with you a few points in no particular order, just to stimulate further discussion. But one thing that I want to emphasize upfront is that each country's situation is different. And the uniqueness of country situations is not to be underestimated, but at the same time, it need not be exaggerated as to use it as an excuse not to benefit from lessons of experience elsewhere. There are similarities, and there are lessons of experience, and there are principles of international law and international humanitarian law in particular that need to be observed under all circumstances. When I stopped counting, there were about 72 different transitional justice experiences around the world. So in the last two decades, there has been a veritable explosion in the number and typology of transitional justice mechanisms. So for both the practitioners and the countries that would like to benefit from these experiences, I think now the discipline is well established.
Mm-hmm.
Another point that I would like to emphasize upfront is that there is no country, no matter how homogeneous, that's immune to conflict.
Mm-hmm.
It could happen anywhere. It could happen in the most stable of societies. Because once the triggers of conflict and division and hatred are set in motion, you don't know whether you are going to stop. Who would imagine that a country like Somalia, where you have 99% of the people who are Sunni Muslims, they speak the same language, not only that, but they all belong to the same Sunni school of thought, and who are all of the same ethnic group divided into clans, that would keep killing each other for almost 3 decades. So if it could happen in one of the most homogeneous societies, it could happen anywhere. And in today's world, even the well-established nation states have some diversity inside them. Okay? You see some of the most established and stable democracies, like the UK, for instance, or even the United States, you have people talking about the Scots wanting to secede and the Welsh being different from the Irish people, and so on. Not to speak of nation states that have only emerged after World War II in Africa and parts of the Middle East. So, once the drivers of conflict are set in motion, we can see them affecting societies in catastrophic ways. Another thing that I would like to emphasize is that as much as transitional justice is meant to provide redress to individuals, it is a societal issue.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And if you look at the conflicts around the Middle East and Africa, you'll see that they affected individuals as much as they affected societies. Iraqis who lived together for a millennia woke up suddenly to realize that they are Sunnis and Shiites, they are Kurds and Arabs, mm-hmm. they are this and that. This is something that was never an issue in the country's history in the past, at least for 600-700 years. Similarly in Syria, what would it take to restore inter-ethnic and inter-communal and inter-religious relations? The social fabric has been the prime victim in all of these societies. So
as much as we look into ways of providing redress to individuals, which is of paramount importance, and also assigning accountability to the perpetrators, we need to pay particular attention to the societal aspects of transitional justice. So, as much as you talk about justice, you also need to emphasize the reconciliation aspect. Another thing that we need to talk about a little bit is how the gender aspect is so crucially important. I am increasingly becoming gender biased when it comes to these processes because my male counterparts, they should forgive me for saying this. I think we men are now becoming the ones who create war, and it is increasingly becoming evident to me that women are the agents of peace. Not only that, in all conflict situations, they are the ones who bear the brunt because men tend to migrate, leave the families behind, women pick up the pieces, and then when it comes to issues of political reconciliation, issues of gender are always glossed over. But unless we emphasize the gender aspect in the national reconciliation processes and in transitional justice undertakings, we miss a lot, and also those outcomes will not stick if they don't have a strong gender component to them.
Could I ask you to pause there, perhaps, for that really powerful point? I'm just mindful of the time, and I wonder if we could collect a few questions, and if you have some pearls of wisdom to save them when I come back to the panel at the end. I know that
let me come back to it later. I just want to emphasize one other important point. Okay, forgive and forget is always the most tempting thing that politicians do after a conflict, and that is precisely the recipe for repeating a conflict. So the idea of transitional justice is not only punishment. The idea is to learn from that conflict as not to repeat it. And the only way to learn from it is to dig deeper to its very minute causes and to analyze them, expose them, assign responsibility, and after that you can think about amnesties or courts or any type of redress. But a proper diagnosis, a proper recognition, and even keeping the memory alive through all kinds of public actions, whether they are murals, they are exhibitions, they are museums, or so on, is keeping the memory alive by itself. Would serve as a safeguard for future generations as not to succumb to that type of conflict. So, the agenda item number one for human rights defenders is to fight against this forgive and forget, which oftentimes comes during the peace negotiations after a conflict. And we as human rights people oftentimes find ourselves being the troublemakers when the politicians want to basically stitch a peace deal very quickly, we come here with the issues of accountability and justice. But it is something that we should never ever let go of. Mm-hmm. It is something that should always become a matter of principle for us. Let me talk about a little bit.
Could I ask you to just hold that for your conclusion?
No, my conclusion is very simple. Two sentences. Let me just say that in OSHR, we offer three things for all of those who go through transitional justice process. Lessons of experience and tools. Second thing, technical assistance, where it is required. Colombia is an example. And networking with other situations where people are working on these issues. And finally, we work specifically on issues of legal reform after conflict. So those are the things that we provide to partners. I'm so sorry for taking
not at all. Every one of your points, especially your last point, was so relevant. So with that, we do want to enjoy the delicious things that the generosity of the missions of Afghanistan and Cyprus have offered us, and that our students have prepared, including this magnificent cake of justice, which they introduced you to. But we do want to harvest the wisdom that's in this room. We also want to hear a little bit of the questions and comments from our own students. So I would request, are there floating mics? If you could just go towards the people. What I would suggest in the interest of time, we promised we would end by 2:30 so we can enjoy the reception. We'll gather about 6 or 7 questions. I would just request the speakers to take note and yes, and we can, even if it's not a question and the answers, really your comments, your insights, your wisdom, your experiences, and we will unfortunately have to be brief, but we would love to hear them. So I see 2 hands already here, I see 1 hand here. I would definitely welcome some calls from the MA students. 3 of our students from St. Gallen are here. I would welcome hearing some of your insights. Yes, please begin over there, gentlemen. Yes, yourself. Do you have a mic yet? No. Do we have just 1 mic? If we could have one more volunteer. Ingrid, could I just ask for your help?
Okay, thank you very much. You touch on everything on the surface.
Can you introduce yourself so we can...
My name is Kamel. I'm here attending another workshop on Nexus on energy and food and water. And I used to be Director of Social Affairs at the African Union Commission in Addis Ababa for 5 years. And that's why I'm taking the floor. It's just to say that you touch on everything on the surface, but I never heard anything about the causality. Why? Because if you think that you talk about a transitional justice, I can just give you right now, at this very epoch, President Obama has put in place over 8 years a system to tackle an incredible injustice, which is healthcare. I'm a medical doctor and cancer epidemiologist, by the way. So when I studied in USA in 1983, I was shocked as a Tunisian that some Americans don't have insurance and they are kicked out from clinic because they don't have insurance. Now what you have election of Mr. Trump, which is an example of how when a big injustice embedded in capitalism, which is globalization, when it hits the whites of America, then you get a populist president. So you are not touching on this. So if I take all this, go back to my Africa, and see 2 big examples of a gentleman called Mandela and a gentleman alive still in Rwanda, where you have 2 people in Africa on their own, they suffered for years in order to understand what the capitalism and its leader who are implementing capitalism and tearing away Africa for centuries. These are the causes. I mean, the gentleman is saying,
I would just request you, we just have 10 minutes to collect all the questions.
If I say one comment, he said that Somalia, 99% Muslim Sunni, he didn't find any difference. But this is because I think the difference. Who put in place those cartel, those differences? Well, it is in the causality which brings in Mr. Trump itself to the floor. You know?
Thank you so much. Thank you for putting the accent on causality right here, please. Yes.
Thank you. Thank the library for putting this together, the panelists and the students. I'm George Papadatos, permanent observer of the European Public Law Organization. Before coming to this event, I did a little reading on transformative justice to Skinner and Ruth Morris. Its main tenets are the abolition of prisons and trying to identify the root causes of the perpetrators of crime rather than imposing a sentence foreseen by the criminal law of a particular country. Can you put into perspective as to what are the practical applications of transformative justice by giving concrete examples, and how does it relate to deterrence in criminal reform? The only person that touched upon these 2 questions was a representative of Colombia. If I understand well, the trade-off is between crimes committed by FARC and the peace justice. Are we willing to forgive
some of those in the name of peace, if I get it right. But anyway, these are my questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Two more right here in front, Dr. Somaruga and Mr. Ritchie. The second mic could come. You could start here. Yeah, this behind, yes. And one.
Thank you very much. I am Cornelia Somaruga from Switzerland. I would like first to congratulate you, Mama, for the extraordinary ability we got with the implication of so many of your students. Although, thank you to the panelists because I learned a lot. I have a question. I missed one value that I think is extremely important in transitional justice. This is forgiveness, le pardon. I think that you cannot have peace without justice, justice without reconciliation, but reconciliation is not good if you don't have auto forgiveness. And forgiveness doesn't lead to forget ever. It's only a personal attitude. Thank you.
My name is Richie, I'm the president of the Conference of the NGOs. I wanted to pick up one point that Adam made. There is, in the world, one category of humanity consistently denied justice, namely women, and including denial of access to the judicial systems. And it seems to me that one of the problems, more than problems, the issues there is the perpetuation of patriarchy as the dominant mode of society in a number of countries. And I would like any views that any of the panel has on how we defeat patriarchy. It needs education to start with, but a much broader type of education than perhaps we have thought of yet. And if I look at one example, what are called honor killings, if we could be sure that these are defined as dishonor to the perpetrators, and that what does not happen, the perpetrators are brought to justice, including the tradition of justice as well. And I can't sit down, Rana, without saying that you continue, after our decades of friendship, when we were even younger, to inspire and surprise me, so I'm looking forward to the next surprise.
Wonderful. The director of the MA in Transitional Justice, right here, please. Yeah. Frank.
So, first of all, thank you very much, Rama, for this great performance for the event. We really appreciate this from part of the Junior Academy. It really has been great to see the students being involved like this, so thank you very much. I would have many, many questions to ask. It is a very interesting debate. I have only two, but I'll try to be very quick. The one is going to the representative of Cyprus. I'm very interested in your case. I was a student from Cyprus. And one question which I find interesting is the question of a truth commission being established in Cyprus. And I've heard that there are some initiatives at the level of NGOs. I would like to hear a little bit more about that from your side. And then regarding Colombia, the question of displacement has always interested me. Could you tell us a little bit more about reparation issues, specifically linked to the issue of reparations in the peace agreement? Thank you.
Even though we won't have time for detailed answers, I would just love to hear from the MA students themselves. Any one of you who has a comment, an insight, a question from your perspective, and of course, if the St. Gallen students might, these are some of our best students. So if they would have something to share, and then we will unfortunately not be able to give detailed answers, but you could give a minute of your closing insights. Come on, you have so much to share. What I should say is that we literally had people from all your four countries and some of the countries that you've served in represented in the class. Please, yes.
So I'm not actually a student with St. Gallen, but I'm a student at MIT. And I had a question. So
what's your name?
Oh, sorry. My name is Multan. transformative justice on sort of larger scales seems to rely on societal narratives. So I wonder if you could comment on shared memory, collective memory, and how that is transformed, or how that needs to be transformed, or could be transformed, in order to achieve this transformational justice. Thank you.
Wonderful. So any of the younger ones, the students? Yes, oh, one more, okay.
Sorry, I'm not a student, but I'm from Afghanistan. Just I heard that the distinguished parliament representative of our country spoke about, but I think reconciliation in Afghanistan will not work without justice, especially the later reconciliation between the government and the Islamic Party. Those the people just watched that they made suicide attack and killed many people in Kabul, and then now just they got a lot of privileges from the government, and the people will lose their hopes and wishes for the future. Thank you.
Thank you. So I guess, one very last comment here, and I may have to let the students off the hook. No one comes forward.
Well, I'm not a student, but I want to make a comment on behalf of the students, also because I had the pleasure to address this class some weeks ago, because I found... Alexander Schiefer is my name, co-founder of the Center of... a Transform Center of Integral Development. And on behalf of the student, the one thing which I would like to bring to our collective attention, I think we saw today something quite unusual. We heard not only an unusual student performance, but in a way an expression of a transformative educational format. And then we heard a lot of resonance from the panel to what you have heard from the students. What I would like to see and encourage more is levels of co-creation between what we hear actually from the young generation, what comes through education, and the institutional establishment in order to drive transformative processes in our country, be it in relation to justice or to any other issue. And thereby, the gentleman who said we need to go deeper to the root causes, activate the power of universities to go to the root causes, which I very often don't do, but I do think in this kind of interchange between what we witnessed here and here, there could be something much more potential to evoke in the future. But congratulations to a great step. I was very impressed on the student side and on the panel side. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, Gretchen, that's a hand. Great. Thank you so much. I think it's so important to emphasize the transformative impact of education and how it could be really a mutual learning between decision makers, policy makers, and the field. Gretchen.
So my name is Gretchen, and I am a student in the class. And I want to say, Madam Ambassador, I am so honored that you're here today, having spent some time in your country and worked with your Ministry of Agriculture. So thank you for being here today. And I want to ask, I think all of the panelists, for people starting out now on this path and this road and looking at transitional justice, this course has really been about the preservation of culture and the less tangible that is all integrated into the transitional justice that's important. So it's the personal stories and it's the growth and the metaphysical side of things. So in a world where you have conflict that's looking at security and corruption and a lot of these hardcore criminal aspects or policy aspects, how do you maintain the focus of some of these things that might be the softer side in light of short of funding, short of human resources, and short of attention? How can we keep some of the spirit alive in the transitional justice space?
Thank you. Wonderful. Well, the good news to the panelists is you do not need to respond to all the questions because we've run out of time and we want to enjoy the reception together and the informal dialogue. So you could pick whatever for you feels like from all the very important points that have been raised about causality, about practical examples, about forgiveness, about patriarchy and justice for women, about creating collective memory, and about the practicality of balancing the hard issues of security with the human issues, whichever seems most important, and just give out literally 30 seconds to a minute of your words of wisdom. So I think we'll go in the same order. So we would start with you, Pastor Dalil. Oops, as you're editing notes. Oh dear. Are you ready? Yes. Okay.
Thank you very much for the feedback and for the questions. I don't say that I can answer all of them, but I will try to in a few areas where I can comment. Patriarchy, I think a few things could work. It's a matter of fact in a number of countries. You say education is one element, but education both for girls and also for boys. Rule of law, the legal basis, for example, for us, the constitution, as well as the rule of law, the implementation, the governance, and also economic opportunities for women. I think those three are key solutions for patriarchy practices. I think the question about how to really balance, how to prioritize those things at the policy level, at the country level, because you have a number of hard choices to make, and you have limited resources. I think they are all interconnected. We cannot see them in isolation from each other. They are mutually reinforcing and interconnecting with each other. And once we improve in one area, that improvement can bring gains in other areas. It's hard. There's no direct solution to these things, but of course, political commitment, innovation, being courageous to do this will be some of the answers. With regards to peace deal with his Bistomia, as Mr. Solihi asked, I would say that, again, it's very much connected to the question that the other colleagues asked, and here how you really balance a number of priorities that the country has. Security is one priority, for example. And of course, development, really to go into the path of development is another priority. And then bringing parties into the table and avoiding violence and extremism is another. And it's how you really balance it in a situation where you have a multi or multi problems and multi priorities. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'll go to you, Pastor Nelson.
Thank you very much. I'm not sure if I'm able to answer all these questions, but I would have to make a short comment. I absolutely agree that forgiveness, rather than wrong, is the most important thing. And I will give some